Hey, John. These buttons don't work. Midweek Lenten 4, good to be home, good to visit, good to see how other people do things, but always a pleasure to worship with your home family as we walk with our Savior, follow his steps. Tonight we'll see that his steps lead us to his Father's house. And I had forgotten, but Jesus cleansed the temple twice. John chapter 2, he cleanses the temple right at the beginning of his ministry, and then he comes back on Monday of Holy Week and cleanses it again. I put a little trivia question out for the kids in my class, in pre-catechism class. Do you remember the question? Was Palm Sunday the last time that people rang out Hosanna to Jesus? Actually, it was on Monday. I don't know if your parents ever said to you, but out of the lips of babes, had you ever heard that phrase? Like, usually it was in the context of someone speaking wisdom as a little child, but it's really tied into our lesson this evening, where those children outlasted those who greeted him on Sunday as Messiah, singing Hosanna from the streets. It was the babes that shouted Hosanna on Monday morning, out of the lips of babes. And how reminiscent it is then for us as we think about Jesus saying, unless you receive the kingdom of God as a child, you may not enter it. Purely clinging to Jesus as we follow his steps as he cleanses his Father's house. The Lord Almighty grant us a quiet night and peace at last. Amen. It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praise to your name, O Most High, to herald your love in the morning, your truth at the close of day. We'll sing hymn number 399. We will sing the hymn according to the melody we're most familiar with, so ignore the score in your bulletin.
What makes this radiant smile? He made all things to run in with the wine. There's time, sweet injuries, yet they are trees. And so they squeeze against his eyes. Hear my
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
the maker of heaven and earth.
Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Almighty God, our Father,
we have sinned against you in our thoughts, in our words, in our deeds, and in all that we have not done. Forgive us in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Deliver and restore us, that we may rest in peace.
By the mercy of God, we are redeemed by Jesus Christ, and in him we are forgiven. Let us rest in his peace until the rising of the sun, when we shall serve him in newness of life.
Amen.
Our passion reading this evening, Matthew chapter 26, verses 57 through 75. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of the law and the elders had assembled. But Peter followed him at a distance, right up to the courtyard of the high priest. He entered and sat down with the guards to see the outcome. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for false evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death. But they did not find anything, though many witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward and declared, "This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and rebuild it in 3 days.'" Then the high priest stood up and said to Jesus, "Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you?" But Jesus remained silent. The high priest said to him, "I charge you under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God." "You have said so," Jesus replied. "But I say to all of you, from now on you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "He has spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, now you have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" "He is worthy of death," they answered. Then they spit on his face and struck him with their fists. Others slapped him and said, "Prophesy to us, Messiah, who hit you?" Now, Peter was sitting in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him. "You also were with Jesus of Galilee," she said. But he denied it before them all. "I don't know what you're talking about," he said. Then he went out to the gateway, where another servant girl saw him and said to the people there, "This fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth." He denied it again with an oath, "I don't know the man." After a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, "Surely you are one of them. Your accent gives you away." Then he began to call curses down, and he swore to them, "I don't know the man." Immediately, a rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered the word of Jesus had spoken, "Before the rooster crows, you will disown me 3 times. And he went outside and wept bitterly. We sing Rock of Ages.
Mm-hmm.
Our text, Matthew 21:12-17. Jesus entered the temple courts and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. It is written, he said to them, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. The blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple courts, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were indignant. Do you hear what these children are saying? They asked him. Yes, he replied, have you never read from the lips of children and infants, you, Lord, have called forth your praise? And he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, where he spent the night. This is God's word. I think I've probably mentioned it before, but at 16 years old, I had the opportunity to wake my way through Europe, and I saw way, way more churches than I thought I'd ever see, and cathedrals, buildings that many of those workers who fashioned those stones together and placed them in their places worked their entire career and never saw its culmination or dedication. As you travel through Europe and you see the size of those buildings, it is absolutely astounding what human hands are able to do, especially when you consider from our day and age without the assist of machinery, gasoline, diesel fuel. These buildings were erected to glorify God on the backs of human spines and human muscles. The one thing that stuck out to me, though, even as a 16, in Omer Emmergau, Germany kid, was that the vast majority of the people in the cathedral were those overweight Americans making their way up to the top of the steeple to look out over the top. There was very little sincere, perceivable religious activity going on. Maybe one or two elderly ladies in the back corner, but most were tourists. There was a vacuum there. What you would expected would be the hub of religious activity was nothing more than a spectator sport for curious tourists. Saw the same thing in Mexico City when I lived there. Part of our job was not only to pick up on the language, but also then to identify with culture and understand it a little bit. And all in the center courts of the city, designed after Spain and what was existing when they were in their imperial height. And yet when you came into the cathedral in the center square of the town, you saw very little religious activity. There was a vacuum there. And the sad thing, what I witnessed on one occasion, was a man literally having a conversation with a wooden statue, as if this were his God that could solve whatever problem was ailing him at the time. He didn't know free and full access to the Savior God that you and I enjoy for the sake of our Savior. As we follow Jesus' footsteps to the cross, we see him this evening going about to cleanse his Father's house. He had arrived to those triumphant shouts of praise. Save us, Messiah, we recognize you. But because it was late in the evening, he withdrew to familiar friends in a cozy bed with Mary and Martha and Lazarus, most likely, late in the evening of Palm Sunday. But first thing he does in Holy Week is to return to the temple. there's a big gap between that early story about Jesus and him being 12 years old and reminding his earthly mother, don't you know I have to be out about my father's business? And then we see him in John chapter 2 going back to the temple right at the beginning of his ministry and cleansing his father's house. And then right away in this week of his passion, this week of passion with purpose, he returns to his father's house where God and man are connected. And he cleanses his temple again. We're outside of the temple. We're in the court of the Gentiles. People were coming back in preparation for the Passover as mandated by the rules and law governing the Old Testament. The need for sacrifice was constantly before their eyes, and whether they had means or not, some brought their own doves. But oh no, your dove's not sufficient for temple sacrifice. You must buy your dove from us. Oh, by the way, there's a bit of an increase on the cost of a dove when you buy it from us. And that money that you bring with the emperor's face on it? No. You need to make your offerings in shekels of Tyre, not the thing that's on your car, but the city. And that's the only sufficient. We have historical evidence that those shekels were being counterfeited by the priests and the ruling religious class. And the exchange rate, you can only imagine when you're the only game in town. Can you understand? From the heart of a perfect Savior who wants nothing more than to bring back God and his people, when this is what's on display in front of him, where he becomes righteously angry and wants to abolish it and remove it because it is an obstacle for people and their Savior, God. It was all about the almighty buck. The duration of the dollar, the right relationship between God and man was based on a paperback bill. So what does Jesus do? He destroys that which is evil. Money in and of itself has no morality. Does it? Whether it's a dollar bill or a gold coin or whether it's a glass bead in Africa centuries ago, money in and of itself has no morality. It only assumes morality when it's in the hands of the human being. And when Jesus views this sinfulness of the religious leaders, he becomes righteously angry and is always angry when things pop up as obstacles between a right relationship between God and his people. True cleansing of his father's house had to take place. I pray that this evening, as we consider our right relationship with God and our right relationship with the resources he placed into our hands, we don't fall into the same trap that those religious leaders did. Oh, how easy it is for us to place our trust in things rather than the one who gives those things. Oh, how easy it is for us to need this temple, not necessarily this structure, but the temple in which God promises that unless a man is born of water and the Spirit, and the Spirit dwells in him, he has no relationship with God. Jesus, as he came to cleanse that temple, comes to us this evening as well to cleanse the temple of our heart so that we may hold on to the one thing that is truly of value rather than the things we claim to have value. There's some cleansing to do before we go to the cross, isn't there? We might think those Jewish people were scoundrels. We might say to ourselves, Lord, I would never do that. Was that an honest answer? Do you look to your paycheck instead of your God? Do you look to the ebb and flows of prosperity instead of the one that undergirds all things? Do you look to your own initiative and innovation and wise choices rather than the one who promised to never leave you or forsake you, who will provide all things? Jesus needs to cleanse this temple as well. And as if that weren't enough, after he levels the obstacles, we see the heart of compassion of our Lord. As if he didn't do enough, right? Having walked on water. As if he hadn't risen Lazarus from the dead. Took time with those 10 lepers and healed them all. Gave sight to blind. Here we are on the week where he knows he's contemplating not only his physical death, but it is the eternal separation from God on our behalf. And what is motivating him? They were bringing the lame and the blind. And instead of his own pity party, he has compassion on them and heals them. As we follow his final footsteps, it not only leads us to the cleansing of his Father's house, it also leads us to the healing of those who are ill. In this sense, physical illness. It was absolutely a demonstration of these are things only God can do. This man, Jesus, dusty as he is, dirty toenails as he has, walking through the streets. This man is completely different than anything else we have encountered. We can even bring those who have need of cure to him. And in the same way as he cleanses the temple of our heart, he comes to us in his compassion and grace and reaches out to us individually to cleanse us from our sin. Culminating with the words, finished, complete, done. Your wounds have been bound up. Your brokenness in Christ is cured. Your forgiveness and spiritual death has been defeated. And now, from the one who gives health, you have spiritual health with God forever. I can hardly do the little things in life when I'm distracted by what's coming up. Christ had far more on his mind, being truly God than we can even imagine, and yet binds up the brokenhearted, provides the cure necessary and the balm to cover up our sins and restore us in God's sight. And follow his final steps. Not only as he cleanses his father's heart, provides true healing that every sinful human being needs, but also turns God's house into a house of praise. There's only two reactions to the gospel. There can only be two reactions. You see them both in our text this evening. Those who heard the words of children preaching a sermon beyond which the greatest of preachers could ever preach, heard that word of God, Hosanna, save us, Lord. Our mercy, our salvation rests only in you. Cause the rejection of some and anger and indignation. They were threatened. If the attention goes to Jesus, then it won't be on us. If he is seen as the only mediator between God and man, what role will we ever play again? So they were angry as they were threatened. And yet the children, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so, proclaim the praise of the one and only Savior, and the so-called adults in the room totally miss it. You may not inherit the kingdom of God unless you do so as a little child. Jesus, Savior, keep us. Jesus, Savior, cure us. Jesus, Savior, cleanse me as I prepare for your passion again. Jesus, Savior, open my lips to sing your praise as the little children sing to you. No more vacuums. No more spaces without real content. Our Savior God's narrative has continued from beginning to end, and he always keeps his promises. As he comes to cleanse his temple, the temple of our heart, as he comes to reveal the blindness of sin and show us the solution of our Savior, as he opens our lips to sing his praise. Amen. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Listen to my cry. Keep me as the apple of your eye.
Hide me in the shadow of your wings.
In righteousness I shall see you.
When I awake, your presence will give me joy.
Be present, O merciful God, and protect us through the silent hours of the night, so that we who are wearied by the challenges and chances of this fleeting world may rest in your eternal changelessness. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, support us all day long, till the shadows lengthen and the evening comes, and the busy world is hushed, and the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then in your mercy grant us safe lodging and a holy rest and peace at the last. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Look down, O Lord, from your heavenly throne, and illuminate this night with the celestial brightness, that by night as by day, your people may glorify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us praise the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be and abide with us always. Amen. We sing the power of the cross.